Well, happy Thursday to you. You're watching CN2 Now. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Lucas McFadden. First up tonight, a Rock Hill man has been sentenced to jail for a domestic violence case which resulted in the death of his wife. 56-year-old Lawrence Florentine of Rock Hill was sentenced to 30 years in federal prison for interstate domestic violence resulting in the death of his wife, Nicole Florentine. According to the police report, beginning in December of 2019, law enforcement here in York County responded to multiple 911 calls made by Nicole, during which she reported that Lawrence physically abused her and threatened to kill her, burn her, and then bury her. Lawrence was arrested twice on domestic violence charges due to those reports. Then in June of 2020, the report says several law enforcement agencies throughout the Carolinas and the Kentucky State Police recovered a partially charred female body from a grave in Kentucky. Detectives say it was later revealed during an autopsy that the body was that of Nicole and that her death was a result from a .22 caliber bullet wound to the head. Authorities say after the murder of his wife, Lawrence left Kentucky and arrived in Denver, Colorado in late June of 2020, where he was arrested. A Lancaster County man has pleaded guilty to hiding a camera in a bathroom and recording young girls who were taking a shower. William Campbell pleaded guilty to two counts of voyeurism and one count of sexual exploitation of a minor, where he was then sentenced to 16 years in prison. According to the report, in December of 2020, the Lancaster County Sheriff's Office received a report that Campbell had placed a camera in a home in Indian Land there in Lancaster County and had recorded video of young girls taking a shower. Investigators searched Campbell's home and seized several electronic devices where they found evidence of that report. Well, stay with us straight ahead here on CN2 Now. We talk about all things Come See Me related. Plus, April is Child Abuse Prevention Month. The Children's Attention Home will join us in the newscast. And straight ahead, big news coming out of the Pennies for Progress 5 referendum.
At Founders, we know your finances matter. That's why we have loans for any reason.
Can Founders help us with our mortgage?
Of course.
Can Founders get me an
auto loan? Not a problem.
Nice.
Can we do something about this?
Home improvements? Absolutely.
How about just getting ahead?
Pay down some bills? We can do that. When you need a loan, our great low rates give you the opportunity to invest in the most important thing, you. So relax. At Founders, we're with you every step of the way.
When it comes to prescription medications and health needs, Rock Hill residents have been turning to Good Pharmacy for over 50 years.
I've been coming to Good Pharmacy since we came to Rock Hill in 1984, and I would not change pharmacists for anything.
With their knowledgeable staff, you can always trust that your prescription will be filled with complete confidence and care for your health. Good Pharmacy, conveniently located at the corner of Ebenezer Road and Camden Avenue.
Live Strong at the YMCA is a lifesaver for so many people.
I love Live Strong because you meet so many people, you learn how strong you can be physically and mentally.
The camaraderie and the closeness that you feel and come together as a group is just amazing.
We meet them where they are and we work with them to help them get stronger.
At the YMCA of Upper Palmetto, we are proud to offer our community the support of the Live Strong program to all cancer survivors. For more information, visit your local branch.
We know the type. You like to start early, finish late, make lemon squares, and make payments to the college fund from anywhere in the house. We know you rely on Comporium for the things you rely on most, like a view of the backyard. That's just a bunny, and hundreds of channels to watch, whenever you want. So you may think of us as just your internet company, but we're more like the I didn't know they could do all that company. Comporium, always ready.
Welcome back to CN2 Now. After meeting for nearly a year, the Pennies for Progress 5 Committee has finalized its list of roads. The Pennies for Progress program, as you may remember, was started by York County to provide residents with a safer and more efficient road system. That 1 cent sales tax is set to expire every 7 years. Here's a look at the latest effort.
What did the referendum come in terms of dollar amounts?
Well, the problem we have is we have a carryover, and it's shocking. It's $225 million. So automatically, we lost more than 50% of what we anticipated to be was going to be around $400 million. So, and the reason for that is most people understand if they have to buy groceries or they're making a lot of money and can't afford week to week still because of the crash that happened with COVID and this tremendous inflation. I think this morning it reported it's really starting to fly now at 3.5% or whatever.
Last month, yeah.
Yeah. So you know, it's a reality. You remember me from my being chair of the council for many years, always talking about watch the taxpayer dollars. And to the Patrick Hamilton's credit, the first part of Pennies 4, first 5 projects were on time, under budget. COVID hit and hell broke loose. And so none of us on the commission liked it, but we understand it. He even gave a rundown because I think the normal inflationary index for, I talked to my construction buddies, 35%. With roads and everything that happened and the right-of-ways and issues, there were 100%, 150% cost overruns. So left a very bad taste in my mouth as well as the other commission members, but we understood. And what we wanted Pennies 5 to do now is just to kind of regroup, collect itself back together, clean up what we have to clean up, at the same time honoring our commitment to the citizens. And that's the first part of the projects, the $225 million carryover. And if you want to go over some of the carryovers.
Sure. So these are carryovers from Pennies 4?
These are Pennies 4 and 3.
Okay. So that are made it on to Pennies 5.
Correct.
Okay.
So you had U.S. 21, Highway 51, and that was from Springfield Parkway up to the state line. And, you know, the mess intersection in that area running off 77. You're gonna make me laugh.
I'm sorry.
I love those sign language things.
I know, I'm sorry.
But and then you had the intersection of Sutton Road, Spratt Road, Fort Mill Parkway. You had from 3 the Highway 557 enhancement. You had the intersection of Highway 49, 274, 557. You had the intersection at U.S. 21 in Springdale. You had the intersection of Sutton Road and Harris. You had the Flint Hill community drainage issues. And then you had on U.S. 21 from Springfield, Pennies 4 group took it from Springfield to 160, which the peach stand is there and stuff. So that's the overruns from the last 3 and 4, $225 million.
So those projects you just listed are part of Pennies 5.
Well, they're carried over to 3 and 4.
Yes, 3 and 4.
So they're part of Pennies 5.
Okay.
And they're the first priority because we want things done. We want to honor the commitment to the taxpayers. Mm-hmm. So then we have $80 million in resurfacing. The good thing about resurfacing, you don't have to get right-of-ways. It's done quick. It should certainly be on time and under budget. So, and that's almost half of what we had to deal with. So we wanted to go ahead and finish 21 from Springfield, I'm sorry, from 160 to Sutton Road, or you could say to the bridge. So then you have another conduit northward instead of just 77. You have 4-lane 21 all the way up. So it's no need to do all this and waiting all this time and then have a mile and a half that we didn't get done. So with the money we had left, it was not a small fraction, but it was just kind of common sense on our part just to go ahead and finish it. One heavy need is the Fort Mill Parkway. If you go down that road, especially around those 4 or 5 schools, I try to avoid it. It's a nightmare. So that's a reality. That was going to be about $90 million. Wow. So we just couldn't do it. So we wanted to at least get it prepared for Penny 6 by bringing forth the design and right-of-way, to finish the right-of-way, do the designing. So once that's done, the Penny 6 people can jump right into construction. And preparing normally takes, you know, at least 3 years to 5 or 6 years. Pennies is every 7 years, so the largest part at least be taken care of. You had the Neely Road corridor that was kind of a last thought on Pennies 4 around South Point High School. that had the asterisk by it, if people remember, when they voted. And that was carried over, but the city came back and said, you know, the way we had it, it's really not what we want. They got the new development going out there, and they came back and said, this is what we want done, you know, intersection improvements, work on a bridge out there. So we agreed to go ahead and honor that commitment with the new proposal from the city of Rock Hill to fine-tune it, make it better. Then just to run down the list quickly, in Tiga K, you had the Dam Road, Gardendale Road improvement intersection, Bethel Street, Jackson Terrace area of Clover. You had the US 21 Old North Main Street, Clover area. You had the Church Street, Liberty Street, Hunter area intersection in York. You had the Liberty Street, Pacific Street in York. You had the Blucher Circle Highway 49 in Lake Wylie. You had the Bonham-Montgomery Highway 49 intersection in Lake Wylie. You have the White Street Corridor Improvements, which is repaving, but it's also improving the sidewalk, the gutters, just kind of redoing a bunch. That's going to be taken care of. You had the Maynard Grayson Highway 55 in Clover. You had the US 321 Flat Rock Road, Huffman Road in Clover. You had the Church Street, Jefferson Street in York. You had the US 321 Deviney Road in York. Three more. You had the Tom Joy St. Paul Church Road in Clover. And the last two, and this was read in the priority list. That's the priority. Last two, Emport Road, Merritt Boulevard Roundabout. And then the last one, Black Street, Albright Road intersection improvement. And that comes to $410 million. So it goes in order of priority. If you don't, you take care of what you take in the order, and then you probably, but our job, our goal was to make sure, and normally almost every Pennies, I was part of three, four, and now I guess with this five, every Pennies always ends up collecting more. So we wanted to be very conservative. We want it to be all cleaned up so there's a nice, fresh start with Penny 6 due to all the inflationary COVID problems and everything that was caused. We just want it all cleaned up.
I love that conservative mindset for that. That's how you get it done.
Britt, we have about a minute left. So at this point, it goes in front of York County Council. They vote either to accept that list or deny the list, correct?
Or deny the list. If they deny the list, it essentially, there's not time to come up with a new road list. So essentially, you kill Pennies and you have to start over.
And then this, if they pass it, it will be put on the ballot and in folks,
November.
We'll see it in November.
Once again, Pennies 5 will have a combined price tag of $410 million. If you want to learn more about the Pennies for Progress program and to see this Pennies for Progress 5 list of roads, check out penniesforprogress.net.
So much of your day is spent waiting. Waiting for the train, waiting in line, waiting for things to download. The last thing you want to do is wait for hot water. End the wait. Rinnai tankless water heaters with SmartCirc intelligent recirculation provide you with unlimited hot water when you need it.
Stop waiting. Get expert sales advice and installation at York County Natural Gas.
I'm Catherine Faircloth with First Community Bank. Oh, doesn't every bank offer the same products and services? Yes, the difference is we are focused on businesses right here in our community. The people that we bank are the people we see in the grocery store. They're the people we see at the ball fields. They're the people we see at church. You become a partner with the customer in getting to where they want to go with their business. It is who we are that sets us apart at First Community. You can't change your DNA, can you?
From my first watch I purchased as a teenager, which still runs today, to the diamond ring I surprised my wife with, which she still talks about today, a gift from Norman Hagee is as good as it gets. Whether it's elegant timepieces by Bulova, Caravelle, and Bel Air, or ornamental ironwork-inspired Southern Gates collection, or dazzling fine jewelry, a gift from Hagee is backed by over 60 years of family-owned and operated experience. Norman Hagee Jewelers, for gifts as good as it gets.
For over 60 years, Gill Insurance has been lucky enough to serve the wonderful people of York County. Everything we do is done with the best interest of our customers and our community in mind. We want to thank each and every one of you who've trusted us to insure their most important assets.
Call on the Gill agencies in Rock Hill, Fort Mill, and now in Mount Pleasant. Independent agents proudly representing Auto Owners Insurance Company.
This is CN2 Now. April is Child Abuse Prevention Month. Here is the Children's Attention Home with their message over the next couple of weeks.
So a lot of folks might see like those pinwheel decorations in and around businesses and homes, and just take us from there. What's the correlation there?
So the pinwheel is the national symbol for like a healthy childhood. And so pinwheels are put out during Child Abuse Prevention Month as a way to call attention to that everybody has a role to play in preventing child abuse and being a champion for children. So like we'll put them out, and we encourage people to put out the pinwheels. And this Friday is going to be Wear Blue Day. And so we encourage people to wear blue in honor of Child Abuse Prevention Month, which will be the same as our open house. So we're excited to have some folks show up and hopefully have an army of blue on Friday.
I do know, Katie, during COVID, a lot of folks were worried for kids because they were not in places where if someone noticed, mainly our schools, if someone noticed a kid was being abused or saw the signs, because we weren't in buildings, we were sheltered at home, that those cases continued to go up more and more and more. I know part of that is your world, part of it's not, but have y'all seen any kind of change since coming out of COVID when it comes to child abuse?
Absolutely. And it is more, really, when you look at Child Abuse Prevention Month, it is prevention. It is how do we get ahead of, you know, making sure that these kids are in a situation where it's a healthy environment, the families are supported, and that's where I think coming out of COVID, there were so many families that, you know, or situations where the kids maybe were not being monitored in a way that was helping prevent that things from getting worse. It also, from a family standpoint, just the stress of the pandemic, the stress of the economy and what was happening at that time exacerbated some of the things that usually will lead to cases of child abuse and neglect, while also not having the monitoring, like you said, of teachers, doctors, and people that generally would see these children on a daily basis. So what we've seen coming out of the pandemic, it's kind of twofold. So one is that you had cases that were underreported, and so it took a while maybe for these kids to be identified, but also just we all had stress and a level of trauma, you know, worldwide when it comes to what we faced with the pandemic and what we all walked through. So for a child that was already dealing with trauma, it just exacerbated what was already happening for them. And so what we're seeing coming out of it is kind of what you see all over the place. You know, there's higher degrees of mental health issues going on and needs, especially with our youth. And also just the, like I said, the trauma that they had, that being compounded by the trauma that was brought by the pandemic and the different, just the different factors that played into that, whether it was not seeing people and the social isolation of it, or whether it was, like I said, the economic impact to their families. So we definitely have seen some of the ripple effects of that. I think it also, I think societally, we were starting to see some of the things that have led to some of this complex trauma and the mental health concerns that our kids are facing today. And so that's really what we're seeing now, is there has just been such an increase in the number of teens specifically, but children in general coming into care that have higher degrees of complex trauma and higher degrees of mental health diagnoses that just need more. They need more help and support to get on a healthy path and be successful long term.
What can we do as a community to help prevent child abuse, and what are some of the warning signs that we should be looking for?
That's a great question, Ashley. So in terms of prevention, really social connection and providing concrete support for families that are struggling is huge. So making sure that we're able to come alongside families. Maybe you know somebody that your child is friends at school with, or maybe it's somebody that's, you know, in your neighborhood, in your church, on your kid's sports team. But keeping your eyes open for places where families are struggling and helping them and being a social connection point for them before things become bad you know, that is critical. And that's what a lot of families don't necessarily have. We look at what, like I said, what society has kind of led towards now between we've been, you know, we're more connected now than ever, and yet as isolated as we've ever been. And I think that's the same thing that we're seeing with families and how that impacts, you know, how well kids are able to be cared for in some of these situations. So definitely that. Some of the signs to look for, I mean, if you have a child that, you know, behaves a certain way, maybe they're usually outgoing or maybe they are a little bit shyer, but you notice changes in behavior. You notice that maybe they're hungrier than usual. You notice that they're maybe unkempt or that they're wearing the same clothes often. They might be really tired or sleepy. So it's a lot of changes in behavioral that you'll notice. And there's lots of other signs and symptoms that if you go on like South Carolina Department of Social Services, they'll have the list for you of signs to look for. But really those are some of the key ones. And then of course for physical abuse would be like unexplained bruises, things right. like that. But yeah, just a lot of it comes to changes in behavior. And then again, just not looking like they've been well cared for. And the number one reason that we see kids come into care is neglect. And so it's that they're in a living situation where their needs are not being met. So that's, again, if we can come alongside families and help provide them with the support that they need, you know, get them connected. If you've got young families that maybe need the support of like parenting classes or things like that, making sure they're connected to community resources that can help them with that. It takes a village to make sure that our kids are well cared for, and we all have a part to play in that.
Once again, the spring open house there at the Children's Attention Home will take place this Friday, April the 12th, from 9 in the morning until 1 in the afternoon.
We know the type. You like to start early, finish late, make lemon squares, and make payments to the college fund from anywhere in the house. We know you rely on Comporium for the things you rely on most, like a view of the backyard. That's just a bunny, and hundreds of channels to watch, whenever you want. So, you may think of us as just your internet company, but we're more like the I didn't know they could do all that company. Comporium, always ready.
At Founders, we know your finances matter. That's why we have loans for any reason.
Can Founders help us with our mortgage?
Of course.
Can Founders get me an
auto loan? Not a problem.
Nice.
Can we do something about this?
Home improvements? Absolutely.
How about just getting ahead?
Pay down some bills? We can do that. When you need a loan, our great low rates give you the opportunity to invest in the most important thing, you. So relax. At Founders, we're with you every step of the way.
My dad is my hero. He taught me how to fish and play baseball. He never stopped looking out for me. I guess he never stopped thinking of me as his little boy, but I don't mind, because I am. What I admired about him most was that he always thought of everything. He even pre-planned his funeral. He planned the perfect celebration of his life. He'll always be my hero.
Live Strong at the YMCA is a lifesaver for so many people.
I love Live Strong because you meet so many people, you learn how strong you can be physically and mentally.
The camaraderie and the closeness that you feel and come together as a group is just amazing.
We meet them where they are and we work with them to help them get stronger.
At the YMCA of Upper Palmetto, we are proud to offer our community the support of the Live Strong program to all cancer survivors. For more information, visit your local branch.
You're watching CN2 Now. Well, the Come See Me Festival starts hopping on this Thursday, as today is the first day of the festival. It starts with the parade. Team leaders responsible for the parade explain why they wanted to volunteer during the Come See Me Festival.
Ryan, for you guys, the planning, the time and energy that gets put into this, you get to see the fruit of your labor come about. What is that feeling like?
It's perfect when we go through it. I mean, of course, there's a couple months of legwork and stuff, but then the day of, you're running around, which is hectic, but kind of fun. And then it almost gets a little calm at about 6. Hopefully, we've got everybody set and ready to go, and you're kind of like, wow, okay, countdown, 6:30, go. And then we get everybody going, and then the last thing, we take our golf cart and kind of ride through to basically tell everybody, hey, thanks for coming out, have a good night. And we just love to kick back, and then you see everyone lining the streets, and you're like, oh, wow, there's a good amount of people here, and everybody's having fun, and kids and families, and
all that
kicking off the festival, and you're like, wow, this is really cool, because you don't realize until you go through it, and then we get to do it last, and it's like, wow, that was really cool.
All that lack of sleep and time and energy, that those are the moments you're like, this is it.
It's brief. You're right there in 10 minutes, but you're like, wow, okay, that was cool. Sorbet Everybody's in. Having a blast, you know. This is great. And then it just kind of rolls from into Friday with
And I know for you, Ryan, with the Gill family, you have deep roots with the Come See Me Festival. And what's that like now? I think, what, three generations? You're the third generation to be able to continue the love and passion for the Come See Me Festival?
Yes, sir. My grandfather, Johnny Gill, was involved from the jump 60 years ago. This is the 60th edition of the festival. So that's wonderful. And a cool story of last night, our festival chair this year, Chris Hood, gave us all kind of as a thank you gift these big green Come See Me flags hang out in front of your house for the next week or so. They're beautiful. Well, I went digging through my grandfather's house and to put it up in front of his house, the big white house on Oakland. And I was looking for a flagpole. I'm upstairs going through old stuff. I find the flagpole, and attached to the flagpole is a really old Come See Me flag.
Aww.
So I got to replace that flag with this new flag and put it up on my grandfather's house on Oakland. So that just happened last night. It was just cool, you know. It's special. It's unique, and it's kind of hard to understand unless you're just kind of a part of it. Not me personally, but everybody who's volunteered, and everybody's got similar stories that have been involved and their parents were involved and now they're taking their kids out. So it's unique to this community, and I think everybody who's been involved holds it near and dear.
And once again, this is the 60th anniversary of the Come See Me Festival. Well, let's get a check of your CN2 NOW picture of the day. Big congratulations to Kim White, a sixth grade social studies teacher at Forest Creek Middle School, for being selected to participate in the Teachers of Government Summer Program. The Riley Institute Teachers of Government Summer Program, what helps teachers make social studies more compelling and relevant by taking teachers right where the topics they teach happen in Washington, D.C. There, teachers get an intensive week of meetings with lawyers and government officials and other policymakers, combined with evening seminars and readings led by Furman faculty. So congratulations to Ms. White there in Fort Mill. Well, that will do it for us for now here on CN2 Now. We will see you bright and early tomorrow starting at 6 a.m. on the radio, WRHI FM 100.1, as well as right here on CN2, Comporium Cable Channel 102. You can also check us out on our social media platforms.
I'm Catherine Faircloth with First Community Bank. Oh, doesn't every bank offer the same products and services? yes, the difference is we are focused on businesses right here in our community. The people that we bank are the people we see in the grocery store. They're the people we see at the ball fields. They're the people we see at church. You become a partner with the customer in getting to where they want to go with their business. It is who we are that sets us apart at First Community. You can't change your DNA, can you?
So much of your day is spent waiting. Waiting for the train, waiting in line, waiting for things to download. The last thing you want to do is wait for hot water. End the wait. Rinnai tankless water heaters with SmartCirc intelligent recirculation provide you with unlimited hot water when you need it.
Stop waiting. Get expert sales advice and installation at York County Natural Gas.
When your gutters need repair, call the company that's been providing roofing and gutter services since 1939, H&S Roofing and Gutter Company. We offer full gutter service, from simple repairs to complete replacement, gutter guards, and even gutter cleanings. In fact, H&S Roofing and Gutter Company was voted Charlotte's best gutter service company by the readers of The Observer. When it comes to your gutter needs, call the best. H&S Roofing and Gutter Company, serving the Carolinas since 1939.
My dad is my hero. He taught me how to fish and play baseball. He never stopped looking out for me. I guess he never stopped thinking of me as his little boy, but I don't mind, because I am. What I admired about him most was that he always thought of everything. He even pre-planned his funeral. He planned the perfect celebration of his life. He'll always be my hero.